this is the Tuesday, this is April 19th, 2016. And six. I'd like to mention that this meeting is being recorded and videotaped. Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't announce the time. The time is, it's about 4:01 p.m. Thank you. Let's see. Let's see. I know we have a member of the public present here today. Would you like to introduce yourself?
My name is Ken Pratt. I live at Salvo.
Okay, thank you.
Boy, am I a crook.
Did you have anything that you would like, a topic that you would like to talk about today?
I'm mostly interested in access to the garden for everybody. Anybody that has any input, I'd like to get it so that there's a number of people at Salvo who have expressed interest in gardening, but they can't get into it.
Is that the one on Portsmouth Road?
Are you talking about the garden over here at Salvo?
The Salvo garden that was by the pines, that was, I believe, the Gazette owns the property.
So when you say they can't, don't have access to it, they're not allowed to go over there?
Physically. Physically, you can't get over the hump to get in, and the paths are not accessible.
So Ken, did this come up at the tenants meeting? Did you bring it up?
I have brought it up three times. The Tenants Association is a farce, for the record.
Okay, so I'm understanding the Gazette owns the property beyond it, or is the Gazette on the property in front and then the gardens are in the back of there?
I'm not exactly sure, but I believe that the Gazette publisher owns that particular piece of property and some way has legally allowed NHA to use it for the purpose of gardens.
I'm wondering, Patty and Jim, there's a possibility you could find out from Wayne Fyden through the planning department if there has been an agreement with the city of permission for accessing, if the Gazette does own that property, into the gardens.
Yeah, because the properties are kind of abutting properties over there. I guess a survey would, you know, absolutely spell out where that 81 Cottage Street building ends and where the Gazette building.
Well, there has to be a survey.
Yeah.
Because the property was bought and it's deeded.
Yeah.
So the gardens have been there for a number of years.
Yeah.
So it's who actually owns it.
Yeah.
I've never been up there, but.
Yeah, if you drive out this way, you'll see it's right on the side of the parking area.
Of the Gazette?
Of the, if you're on Salvo property, mm-hmm. when you're driving out,
yeah.
so if you're going out that way, the gardens will be on your right-hand side. You can't miss it because it's...
You can see the gardens?
Yeah. So it's like
it's
a strip.
It's not way in the back.
No.
There's no gardens active right now, but there are five large pines that will show you where the gardens start.
There's a lot of, there was a lot of other debris around it from people gardening.
And does the housing authority own that where the gardens are, Patty? Or is there an understanding? See, that is, that development with the housing authority is federal government. Federal and state. And that's why there's a board. And the mayor selects what, two or three people on it to get on it, but we don't have any responsibility with it.
So what I'll say about just what I know in the garden is that John Height allowed that to be done. And a lot of people at Salvo are the ones that are doing it because they have something very small over at McDonald House. So whether or not the Gazette owns that property and has allowed them to use it, or if it's housing authority and the housing authority said, yeah, go ahead and use it, I guess that's what the question is. Yeah. But I think, you know, it's usable already as a garden. Now, I think what Ken's issue or concern is about people who may need access because of what, a wheelchair, a walker?
It's difficult for me, and I'm relatively mobile.
So, have you brought this issue up to the association?
Yes, three or four times.
What did they say?
The Tenants Association is in the transition phase, to be polite.
Yeah.
They are not very effective on many different issues. Nobody seems to care except for a few of the
tenants,
yes.
Do you have something that you'd like to say, Leticia?
I was just saying I can't do May 17th.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear what you
said. I said I can't do May 17th for the next meeting.
Yeah, we'll get to that after we need to let finish, honey.
I just wanted to make sure that we took time for introductions today. For introductions. So.
Can I say one thing before we move on?
Oh, sure.
Basically, the Housing Authority is under the HUD 504 regulations. They have the same essential structure as the ADA. If a number of residents with disabilities are seeking improved or accessibility to a program, which is the gardening, there is a similar reach of the legal obligation, which is probably not well known. So I think it would be appropriate in some way for this commission to basically support that communication. It would be helpful, of course, to get some photograph of the condition so we know exactly what we're potentially talking about, but to encourage them to pay the attention to an expressed interest of a number of residents who'd like to garden.
So what you're suggesting, Chris, is that our commission write a letter to the president of the association in regards to the information that you just presented to us?
Whether it be a letter or whether it's a communication through the ADA coordinator, I can't say which would be necessary. I think the first thing is usually simpler is a telephone call and just see if there's openness and receptivity. You know, another voice chiming in on an issue.
Who's sometime. The president of the association?
Presently, her name, first name is Mary. However, on May 12th, we're having new elections, so all of that will shift over.
But it would also, it would be a communication to the Housing Authority.
Yeah, I think with the new director that they have now.
Right.
Yep. I don't even know her name.
Kara is her first name, and their last name is escaping me. So I will give her a call tomorrow, see what's up.
All right. I would like to make time for member introductions today. Would you like to start, Letitia?
With interrupter?
With introducing yourself today?
My name is Letitia Ward, and I'm a full member of Committee of Disabilities.
Chris Palamas, member.
Pat Chauncey, ADA coordinator and member.
Hannah Coyle, chair.
Ruth McGrath, secretary.
Member.
James Winston, member.
Thank you. Thank you. All right. Did everyone read the minutes of the January 19th meeting and the March 2015 meeting?
You would have just got the ones for March 15th, and the January 19th would have gotten way back when.
Yes, I did.
We had no meeting in February.
That's right.
Are we going to skip a month this time? Are we going to do every month?
We didn't have a meeting in February because the senior center was closed because our water suppression system was not functioning, so the building couldn't be opened.
No.
Does anyone have a comment on the January 19th minutes or the minutes for the March meeting, March 15th meeting?
Do you want to go over any time separately or just one?
I guess we could vote on, if there's no comment on either minutes, we could vote on them together.
I second it.
Okay, all right, thank you. Who would like to make a motion to pass the minutes as written?
I'll make the motion.
Thank you.
I second it.
Thank you, Letitia.
No problem.
You're welcome. The next item on the agenda, I received a letter from the Mass DOT, and the subject matter is the Amtrak station in Northampton and Greenfield. they have been using 46 foot long platforms, and these initially were being tested as interim platforms, but over the course of time and ridership, they have decided to make the use of the 46-foot platforms permanent. They specifically would like to keep using this specific platform, let's see. Initially, what they'd like to do is replicate the existing 46-foot platform segments to 120-foot segments in length, because this would help increase the accessibility of people who are boarding the trains instead of just one one train per track. They'll be able to have ridership of three trains per track, getting individuals filling the train at a time. I don't know if let's see. So right now they have a ridership, the trains and the tracks itself are all accessible to all. I don't know if anyone has visited the new Amtrak station yet in Northampton or Greenfield yet.
No, I have not.
No.
Can I ask, are they asking for any action from us? Is this just a notice of intent?
This was a notice of intent. This was a notice of intent. And so, and so initially, the MassDOT basically has requested more funding because they wanted to increase the platform to 120 feet. Right now, that funding request is pending and it hasn't yet been granted. So that is something that we may be updated on in the future. there was a letter from someone from Mr. Gibson in Washington, D.C. And he wanted to affirm that all ridership on Amtrak is accessible, and that we should, you know, maintain that accessibility. And then there was also something that I'm not familiar with. I don't know, perhaps you are, Patty, if you've ridden trains in the past. But this, it says, reversing trains in order to reposition cars at the mini high platform is currently operationally permitted and shall not be discouraged. Let's see, this is what I wanted to read to you. I guess any passenger boarding a train via the platforms can request to board any car in a train that is being made available to passengers not needing the mini high, and the train crew is both authorized and required to reposition the train per supplemental train crew instructions. So it sounds like there's the opportunity for people to board the cars on what is called a mini-high platform or not. And they have something that's called a reverse movement within the limits of the same block. I wasn't quite sure. I read through that and that didn't make that, I'm not quite sure. That might have.
Could I take a look at that? I have ridden the train. I always picked it up in Springfield, mm-hmm. where they used a lift. So if we have a high platform, mm-hmm. That's a lot better than a lift. But
right.
It sounds like it's currently small. There's a request for funding to expand it to a three-car length,
mm-hmm.
which would give more choice. And then there is some procedure by which the operators of the train would actually reposition, because you might be seeking access to a specialized car, or how the train is aligned, it might require require movement. I would wonder, is it Massachusetts that has to allocate more money to accomplish we would want a more extended high platform. Is that a holdup of either Massachusetts or federal money? I could look up quickly.
They are seeking money from, they have a pending request, a capital investment plan. The Mass DOT has placed the request with over the next few years, between 2017 and 2021.
Does it say who the request is to? Is it like the Mass Legislature, or is it the federal government?
They didn't put that in the letter.
And is what they're looking for a response?
No, they just wanted to inform us that they're satisfied with the use of these mini high platforms, because initially they were going to only be used as interim platforms.
So only one people.
Correct. So
I'll pass that over to Chris. There's some pictures with this.
Yes, there's a couple. There's a photo of the Northampton track and train station, and there's also a photo of the Greenfield train station. Give people time to look at that if they would like to look at the photos of the Northampton station and the Greenfield station, if you'd like. I would also like to go over to the Northampton station.
Me too.
And take a look at it to see. If I can make any recommendations for accessibility issues there. So.
That'd be cool to go and check it out. I would like to go with you sometime.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. I'll let you know.
Thank
you. Or you can just stop up there anytime. That's available. So
what is parking like up there? Does anybody know?
Union Station, the Depot.
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, there's that huge lot you have to pay for parking, but there is ample parking there.
If you just want to go and look around, you still have to pay for parking?
Well, I mean, if you're right there, as a practical matter, and you're not going too far, you could see if parking enforcement was there, and then if they were, just go back to your car.
Oh.
But what that discourages is, like, if you left your car there and then you walked to downtown.
Oh, is it metered?
Yeah. Well, you have to pay for the park, just like anywhere.
I wonder what disability plates would do. I know with meters, I don't have to pay.
Yeah, I think there is some, right.
so I could park.
Yeah, I think there's definitely spots.
We want to use the train to go to Washington, but I've been afraid because I wasn't sure, you know, about parking, about getting on the train. I can't do stairs, you know, things like that.
Yeah, the parking lot that's closest to Pleasant Street is I'll call it metered, even though you get a ticket. And then the upper parking lot that is actually closer to the station is privately owned by the Union Station or whatever it's called now.
Maybe you get in touch with them just to get clarified about handicap plates and parking. It might be a good thing just to know for everybody that's.
Yeah, and also if you're going to leave your car for a few days, it won't be trading.
Yeah, just from experience with people who have parked in private parking lots, like some of the stores, and it has a handicap placard, it doesn't work. But the meters, okay, the ticketed spots would work just like anywhere, because anyone with a placard or a handicap parking plate can park.
I think if we were going there, we'd get a ride, because I don't like leaving the car.
Yeah.
You know, we'll be here too.
Understand that, yeah.
Just turn it up there.
Yeah, I haven't been up there, so I haven't taken that train. Yeah.
But the train hasn't been running between Springfield and New Haven because they've been working on the tracks. So you would then get off and take a bus from Springfield to New Haven and get back on the train until they finish the work.
Yeah, our buses are nice, but some of the other ones aren't.
That's true.
Excuse me, may I explain quickly?
Sure.
This is a letter to Tom Hopkins, mm-hmm. who is the director of the Massachusetts Architectural Access Board.
Mm-hmm.
And the Access Board previously provided an interim use of a mini-high platform, but it was subject to the construction of a full-high platform. Mm-hmm. So the question now is whether the board will amend its requirement that the mini high be allowable only for a period of time until a full high is constructed. What they're arguing is that a longer length of a partially high platform would do the job, and a full 400 foot long platform is not necessary. I'm not sure about that. In principle, I think that's an important one to take a look at. They're saying, given current levels of utilization of the station, this relatively short accessible platform is usable at some period in the future. If trains were to be more readily funded and more highly used, I think this is probably something that we just want to be aware of and potentially be in contact with Tom Hopkins to see what the interpretation of the board is. Mm-hmm. The board is going to be. Basically, they're saying they were required to construct a 400 foot long, and they want to do substantially less than that because utilization has proven that at this point that that's adequate. The amended piece about backing up and going forward would be if something were to happen where the number of cars that were accessible, theoretically, something would occur, the train crew can either back up or move the train forward. That's just an amended procedure. So I think this is one that we ought to be aware of. And in principle, if they were required to do a full 4 foot high platform, my inclination would be to think that that is something that, unless they can prove that there is a substantial financial implication there, an undue burden kind of implication, mm-hmm. they ought to be held to the ruling of the Access Board. That would be at least my first inclination on this.
The next item on the agenda, I have wanted to talk about recognizing Ms. Shaughnessy's work as ADA coordinator. Just an informal, an informal meeting, an informal gathering, a relaxed gathering, just to spend some time chatting about our past accomplishments as a committee and a commission. Perhaps if you'd like, we could listen to music. If anyone has any interest, we could possibly gather a few photos of some of the sites where the commission has accomplished its work.
That'd be a good idea.
And if you'd like, we could have we could have beverages. I wanted to broach the topic with the commission to see if they would like to do this.
July 1st, is that when you're retiring?
July 6th.
6th, okay. So the last full meeting would be the June meeting then?
Yes.
Okay.
Great.
Yes, I would like to do that.
Thank you. Would we like to do that during the June meeting, or would you like to meet at a time, I know you might be busy after you retire.
Well, I'm gonna say I appreciate the thought. I know how busy everybody is, and I really don't like having time taken for me personally. So if anything, maybe at the June meeting, we could have our meeting, and then afterwards for, you know, 15 minutes or something, we could have some light refreshments. That's you know, I don't expect anything. I just think that, you know, it can be business as usual. And and when you're talking about putting together photographs and our accomplishments, I'm thinking, oh, all that kind of stuff would be great for our table at the health and safety fair, you know, kind of our archives.
That'd be great.
So that's what I say. Again, it's a wonderful gesture.
I think there are two levels here. One is the appreciation for you personally.
Yeah.
And there may be several, you know, with your colleagues and the people in the town who you've given great gifts over these years. And then there is the particular of this commission, and certainly your reflections on your sense of what's been, what you've seen change over the years, and that there might be something that remains to be done. But you keep it light and as comfortable for you.
Well, again, I, you know, appreciate people's time, but everybody is just so busy. And I think if we do something for a brief period of time after or during our meeting, however you want to do it, is it enough? Thank you.
You're welcome.
I think we usually make a motion, but maybe since it's, I think we usually would.
I motion that.
I'll make a motion, and Leticia made a motion, I'll second a motion that we show Patty Shaughnessy our appreciation and respect and good wishes for retirement at our June meeting, immediately following the meeting, if you want to have a little snacks while the meeting.
Well, I was mostly thinking of just beverages, to keep it light, But I mean, if someone did want to bring snacks, that would be all right as well.
But yeah, I was just thinking that maybe just some beverages might be nice.
Should we do it as a surprise party?
I suggest, yeah, let's just plan that separately, yeah, so that we'll have the rare experience of probably not being responsible for securing refreshments for.
Yeah.
Okay.
I'll invite the Beatles.
All right. Good. Beatles, that'd be great.
Yeah, that would be quite enjoyable.
My dad would come back from the other
world, right? Yeah.
It's in a comment.
Well, thank you.
Next thing on our agenda is...
Can I ask before we move on, is that topic is the ADA coordinator? Mm-hmm. Do we yet know who might be appointed next, what the process might be? What the participation of this commission in that process might be?
With the job description of the director for Northampton Senior Services, part of the responsibility is being the ADA coordinator. So whoever is hired in that position is also the ADA coordinator. The mayor is the appointing authority, and at some point somebody will be hired in that position. Hopefully before I leave.
So the person, as the interview process goes forward, in the job description, is the very substantial responsibilities that you've experienced up to, to deal with a host of disability issues. The top of the list is perhaps the ADA, but not the only one. That, to me, suggests that something in that process of interviewing and review of the candidates might be a matter of interest.
I think that's a very good point or comment. I think if anybody on the commission would like to serve on the mayor's hiring committee, so that the ADA portion is well reviewed, that you should send a letter or give a call, probably a letter, to the mayor's office saying that you'd be interested in serving on the
big problem.
Hiring committee for the director.
Leticia, would you like to speak about the crosswalk on?
Oh, right, yes.
Before you start, Leticia, I just want to say I left a copy of a picture of the crosswalk that Chris Palamas had sent to me. And then Ruth, there's also a packet of pictures that I'll pass around that Ruth brought in. So here's some additional pictures that you can pass around. I'll bring them this way. Ruth brought those in. And then the one that Chris Palamas sent me.
This is the area over by
on Elm Street at Smith College Campus Center.
Well, what is this? I know that crosswalk.
Yeah, you know what I want to
say? I was guessing as we came down, so I snapped this picture.
I don't find a problem with that.
Yeah, I stopped to get out of the car and took a bunch of both sides of the street and the cross street that comes out of
those there.
And you know, the whole area, the signage that's there.
So the whole reason this is on our agenda is because Leticia was hit by a vehicle at that crosswalk. Is that right?
Yeah. Not where the light is, but where the campus center is.
Right. The crosswalk's right there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That nasty crosswalk. Yes.
It's this one.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that's it, right?
Yeah.
I don't have a problem with it.
So.
You, Chris.
And as I look at that, well, we should ask you what happened.
Oh God.
And what's your perception of that?
Yes.
All right. That crosswalk is really bad because drivers speed and they don't watch the dressing, and that it was foggy that night and it was dark, but. People said I had dark clothes on, and they need to put something right there, and...
Put something like what, honey?
Like like a flashlight or something, so like if people, like if it's foggy, I don't want to get a headache because it was foggy. You remember that night, wasn't there? Oh, when you were away?
I didn't even know about it, I was away.
But it was foggy that night, but they need to do something about it.
To make it brighter?
Yeah, for like drivers and stuff, to see pedestrians.
There is a light.
I wonder where the nearest light is.
I think they're on each end. Yeah. I think they're right at the
crosswalk. There's no light on the crosswalk, but
yeah.
I have a picture of the signage in there.
Where is the light?
Here's, as you're coming up our way.
I was checking
one crosswalk. John is the second one.
This way.
Over that way.
Yeah, you're going towards the center of Northampton.
Yeah. Right, it's the second Smith College crosswalk.
So right after that yellow house on the right is John and Green Hall.
Is it right for, I mean, if you're...
Oh my God, I was going to show you guys.
It's before you get to Henshaw.
Yes. The picture you just gave me, right down here is the full-blown light, which has the gates. You can just cross the street on both sides and go right into campus.
Right at John and Green Hall.
Exactly.
This is the one right here, and the other one. So this is the nasty one.
That's the nasty one. That's the one we're looking at, Leticia.
Yeah.
So we got the right crosswalk.
Yeah, there's no stop right here. Crosswalk.
No, there's not.
There is yellow paint on either side of it going down into the street. I got pictures of that. And there's signage on both sides, and I took pictures of that. That's in there somewhere too.
And it looks like the paint is still well marked on the crosswalk.
Do you remember that foggy night? Or were you away?
I don't remember. I don't know when it happened.
It happened.
The only thing I can suggest is that I'm hearing a foggy night. That's a problem. I'm hearing dark clothes.
Second problem.
Yes.
But let me say something about crosswalks. Mm-hmm. This is a common problem, and people have struggled in a lot of different ways with how to solve it. So you will see over in Amherst, for example, in their central intersection, where they took and now they've raised some of their crosswalks, that there are lights to basically indicate to slow in crosswalks. Very often crosswalks are not respected. That's a problem of traffic control. Mm-hmm. There are design solutions that can give better warning or do more to slow traffic. But like anything else, that's a matter of how many would you put in and where would you put them in. The most immediate is improved lighting if that is contributing in some way.
Was the driver sighted? Was the driver too fast for the speed limit there?
He was driving too fast, and he didn't see me. I went over his car.
Did the police say he was at fault?
He got a ticket.
Okay, so this was a problem with the driver.
Yeah. And it was foggy too, that's what they...
The only thing I
weather conditions say, being foggy.
If you look at the signage there, and there's this on both sides, there's no lights on it. Like the pedestrian crossing signs that are out here?
Over here by ultrasound.
That's what I was just saying. If they added a light on the top, flashers.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. See, there's no street light, and the pedestrian crossing signs don't have lights on them at all.
That's not reflective paint.
I don't really notice it much at night.
Maybe Smith College would donate it.
That would be nice. I will say, coming down here for this meeting, I was about four cars back from the intersection and took my camera out and filmed people on the side trying to get across, and the traffic just kept right on going. Mm-hmm. but there was nobody standing there.
And I've gone, and I travel that every day, and I see some of them who don't even stop.
Yeah,
they just come right out.
Maybe we need to request the police officers sit there and ticket people for.
Exactly.
And,
I agree.
And I can't remember the officer's name that was there that night, but I think that police officer, I think it's the same guy, but I forget his name, because he took care of me that night, and he, one of the people that's working at Smith College saw it too, and there was like nurses or doctors from there that, and I'm still terrified of crosswalk. I'm still terrified. I know it's in the past, but I'm still afraid though.
So what would you suggest that as a commission, possibly send a letter to the Board of Public Works, right, Jim Lorillo, and also a letter to Smith College, to the president of Smith College, whoever.
I don't know.
In regards of the concerns of that sign, possibly send a picture, the good one that Ruth had, of suggesting possibly talking with our engineers and having the flashing lights place on.
There's one point I'd like to make. There's a problem with traffic, but there's also a problem with students. They feel very enabled, and you'll see them just come running down the sidewalk.
That's what I said.
Run right out in the street and just assume the cars are going to stop.
Yeah.
The nice thing about these crosswalks over here is they have to stop and push a button. That stops the pedestrians from running out, and then the cars see the
flashing. I like that, too.
I mean, I think that might help both problems.
Yeah. Yes?
Okay, I was just going to say, to Ruth's point, the Smith College students, a lot of times they are looking at their cell phones, they're not looking. Actually, I think the Elm Street, I find just the opposite, and I grew up on Crescent, and I still, I'm always around there walking my dog. And I notice a lot of cars will kind of break, even if there's nobody there, just out of force of habit. They're trained at the Henshaw and at Round Hill to stop. It's a lot more problematic. Crosswalks that they don't, especially Prospect. Prospect at the end of Franklin, that connects Franklin Prospect, that people go through. If you had a police officer there, you would really catch a lot of people, and that might be the answer. But I think at least on the Elm Street one, they're trained, they know the students are coming out there. And the one by John and Green Hall that, could, you know, that connects the campus in north of Bridge Island, the other side, they always stop there.
They do.
And in fact, I see sometimes where there's a light there, John and Green Hall, and the light is green, and you have students standing there, and they know they have to wait till the light turns red. I still see cars stop even though they've got the green light, because they're so conscious of Smith students.
Exactly.
Yeah, I mean, one appears as a major crosswalk, and then some others get lost. I don't know what's going on with the technology. Is there greater reflectivity?
I guess so.
Well, Smith did a lot of things. They actually shortened down the street. The wideness of the crosswalks was shortened a number of years ago when they redesigned Elm Street. So the crosswalks are shortened, and then that big project around Round Hill, crosswalk there where they made it raised. They've done a lot of improvements, the Smith College and the city, to make Elm Street area, that part, safer.
Mm-hmm. I could
say, like, when you're coming through the full-blown light on Main Street to come up past St. Mary's, then you have the first street on the right-hand side, correct? You have a light there, right?
Yeah.
Go a little bit further, and there's another light.
Yeah, right.
And then when you go a little further past, before we come to this, is a sign of signage. That's it. So it doesn't make sense to me, two lights, which is a skip and a hop, and then not a light.
I know.
And that is really used a lot, because it's right near the campus center, that crosswalk.
Mm-hmm. And I don't like that crosswalk either.
That third, to put a third light there?
No, I think they should put a flasher on the sign.
Well,
okay, maybe a flasher.
I'd like to say,
you know, like just flashing.
Yeah. I don't think
the same sign, but a flasher.
Okay.
So to educate the public, my main concern is educating the students.
Yeah.
But Mary, that's a big one.
Mary, I personally, I think flashers on the signs don't work very well, because when I've been traveling in cars, I don't find that the reflectivity of the flashers is very bright or very strong.
So,
idea is, if someone could put a light of some sort on a utility pole nearby to the crosswalk. As you can see, there's a utility pole right here, right near the crosswalk. If you could put a bright light slightly above the sign.
What kind of a light?
Bright white light.
Could I suggest, yes. We don't want to get into engineering.
Exactly,
those are not our skills. This is short of suggesting a new stoplight. Mm-hmm. But the question to the engineers is, in terms of what's been established in research, mm-hmm. is there something that increases the visibility of this kind of signage?
Right.
Because it is a high traffic crossing, but not at the point where you put enough stoplight. Right. And that's where we should stop and not get into, because frankly, I don't know. This or that solution is more effective.
And he's absolutely correct, because anything that we do mm-hmm. as city councilors and working and same with Patty, mm-hmm. what was all done out there was done by engineers of what the state regulations are, okay?
You said
also, no matter what stop signs, any kind of directional lights like I have on Route 66, mm-hmm. that costs 200 and something thousand to put that up. Mm-hmm. A full-blown light, okay? We didn't make that decision. Mm-hmm. The engineers did, because of all the amount of accidents and so forth like that. Our commission cannot say, I want you to do this and I want you to do that. Our role is to say, can you help us? We need the expertise of our engineers and our department to help us come in and say, what should be done in that site?
If we could talk with people at Smith, if we could talk with people that might be willing to invest in some bright white lights to put on utility poles near the please yield to pedestrians.
They have to work with our engineers.
They have to work with the city's engineers to do that?
Yes.
They're the ones that are trained in what's the best solution for this.
Right.
So if we talk to them, maybe we can have one of the city engineers come to a meeting.
Yeah,
Do you think we should write a letter to them now, or do you guys don't think it's a good idea?
Yeah, Marianne suggested we write a letter. So, you know, we can let them know what the situation is and ask them if they'd be available to come to a meeting to talk mm-hmm. with us about what solutions are out there.
I agree to that.
Okay, another thing too, Patty, we do have a commission on transportation and parking, mm-hmm. okay? To me, that's the beginning right there
yeah.
of bringing it in. We have the Department of Public Works there, we have the police department there, mm-hmm. the fire department there, all the appropriate departments of saying, we have a problem at this site, these are the suggestions, and then move forward.
What's the best way to get in touch with them? Email or just call them?
Patty can call them. To put it on the agenda.
Don't be asking.
And that's going to be because I got something else going on the agenda, and it's going to take 2 months.
And I would think that I don't recall how many years ago that Smith College student was hit
yes.
and killed on a crossing.
Yeah.
That there would be a lot of documents related to that and recommendations as to how that whole area could be improved, which. I know some things had been done.
Hey, don't be asking my favorite thing.
I also know that Smith College put in some money toward that, too.
They did at one point have flashing lights in the sidewalk,
yes.
which I thought was really
that.
Good.
Yeah.
Hey, don't be asking my favorite police officer to come to the meeting because he was there that night. Don't be asking him.
So it's up to you which way you want to do it. You want to do it.
Mm-hmm.
Either
I can say, mm-hmm. I'm concerned in terms of a bigger question about the agenda for this commission.
Mm-hmm.
this is a matter of what the current practices and advancing technologies are in illumination, et cetera. That to me is an inquiry. It's not another meeting for this commission. I think what this commission has to do is that bigger question, have we had and should we be revising a broad and general self-evaluation and transition plan that prioritizes dozens of issues for the city? If we fill up our agenda pursuing a single one at a time, you know, this isn't important. It's a high traffic intersection. There's the question of what are the best practices to use right now. Communicate that and ask the appropriate department to communicate back. But do not schedule for each one of these another meeting with the commission, or we won't get to the bigger picture, which is that there are hundreds of serious pedestrian hazards in and around the central districts.
So what you're saying,
of the city, that's what I think we should be focusing on, trying to get a handle on. And when we get those hundreds or dozens, then you start assigning relative priorities to them.
I agree with that, but I don't think we should ignore
exactly
the specific situations, because
like mine,
this is going to take months or even
exactly
longer to do. In the meantime, somebody could get killed.
This would take 2 months. Just right now, I have something on Route 66. 2 months. I've been told this morning to get it on the agenda.
Why? What happened?
Yeah, well, I don't want to talk about that right now. So,
but I agree, we do need to look. We've talked about that before. And
right. I don't have a problem that we reach out to the appropriate departments, because we know what the appropriate departments are that handle the situations of safety.
I just, you know, I
so I think reaching out when we know there is a problem, I think we have the rights to go ahead and immediately write a letter, do something to inform them that there's a problem that's been brought to our attention.
Yeah. Do you think they should come to our meeting?
The picture is great too.
Do you think they should come to our next meeting?
And I don't have a problem with that, reaching out and writing a letter to the Transportation and Parking Commission.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and the police department, Jody is there, the chief.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And the engineers are there, so we're reaching out.
Yeah.
Yeah. I would just like it to be in a broader
right
context. I'd like to know from the police department, what would they identify as the most dangerous intersections in town, what's been brought, and so there can be some sense of apportionment among. This is a high traffic intersection,
yes,
and a critical area where you've got lots of students crossing and you have a history of injury.
Like mine.
Exactly, so are there others that fit into that same category? That's what I'd like to see.
And see, we would not be able to do that, Chris, in the rural area, because we do have Park Hill Road, we have Portsmouth Road, we have Florence Road.
Oh my God.
You know what I'm saying? I have Ryan Road. And it's like, when there is danger in place, we move immediately on it. And that's what we're doing with Route 66 right now, because of the safety of children who have to get on a bus and cross that. It's a massive highway, very, very busy. It's a main artery. Am I gonna sit back as a counselor and say, well, let a child get killed? No, we're moving on it immediately. You know, so if I sat back and said, I'm not gonna bring it to the appropriate departments,
yep,
something would happen.
Yeah, but that's the point. It has to go to the appropriate department.
Exactly.
That's true. And I don't want you to sit back. That'd be, then you'll kick yourself in the foot if you do that.
Oh gosh, that would hurt.
It's just an expression.
Yes.
Yes, time to move on.
Yes.
Okay, I'll make a motion that Patty Shaughnessy get in touch with Transportation and Parking regarding this matter, and see how they want to proceed with it, if they want to come to a meeting, or if they want more information.
I'll second that.
Thank you.
So it looks like we will be tabling the next few items on the agenda for the next meeting.
Let me at least hand these out so people can look at them.
I'm going to help you pass them.
Sure. Yes.
This is the proposed brochure that we talked about last month. I ran out of cardstock, so I apologize. It's on paper. But picture this as just a, I also need a bigger so it's easier to read. But if you picture this on a piece of cardstock, and this would be the back. One change I made, I get rid of the wheelchair, I went out online and found a more universal symbol for disabled. It says positive about disabled people. And if anybody's interested, I also went out to Massachusetts Office on Disability and got their statement, added that. I have some different Massachusetts brochures here if anybody wants to see what other cities are doing. I printed some of those. And just, if you would look at those over the month, and then maybe at the next meeting, come back with any suggestions or changes and things. And just for your information, I got a letter from the Massachusetts Office on Disability. They're going out to all the secretaries of all the commissions asking for corrections and changes.
I don't have that.
I just, it's like 19 or 20 pages long.
Oh, you have a copy that.
I think you gave us that.
Yeah.
We have to update ours to put Hannah down as chair, that's all. So that's the only correction that needs to be done for now. But keep it in mind, so when we do lose Patty, we can update that.
So can I ask, what is this?
That's the brochure. We talked about last month, we said we were gonna make it a card with just a front and a back. I didn't have any cardstock, so I printed it on paper, and I just made it bigger so people could read it easier. But it would be printed down, and the front page is the front of the card, and the second page is the back of the card.
So it would be like this.
Oh, I gotcha. Well, Chris is very good at that. So we'll use your expertise once we all look at this at some time. What needs to be, if something should be added on it, something taken off on it.
Yeah, that's, I just don't want to bring them out so you can.
Yeah, this is good, that way we can study it.
These are samples from other cities in Massachusetts, what they're using for brochures. And I have more at home, I just brought a few samples, if anybody wants to look at them.
I like this brochure, I think you did a great job.
Thank you.
Well, I think we should, because of the health and safety, we need to have something that maybe tentatively could be put together.
You're right.
And then the commission can vote on the final product, but we need something.
Who's gonna run the table, or just gonna leave it? I think it's understood we're leaving it on the table.
Yeah, it could be left if anybody wants to sit there.
I sat there last year, remember? And the year before I did it with, what was her name? Cindy and I did it. This year, I can meet him for the first hour.
What do I have to do?
After that, I have to read.
What day is that?
It's.
May 12th.
Yes, it's May 12th, the health and safety fair.
10 to 2.
Oh, I can't do that the 12th.
I can do the first hour.
Where do these pictures belong, Patty?
We can keep them as our.
I want this one, though.
And I'd also like people to think about the term that I had introduced last month, individually abled. I would like people to see how comfortable you are with saying that. But I like that term to describe or be a replacement for disabled people, because I feel that it's a more positive term for disabled people, and it really accentuates the fact that each person is an individual. So we could even put positive about individually abled people on the brochure.
I'm sorry. There's language that is generally used, and it's language that's embedded in law, and people have been concerned about this for a long time. There was a $25,000 national competition some years ago by the Christopher Foundation, and after a national solicitation, they came up with people with differing abilities, which no one has used since. This is a commission on disability.
That's true.
It is about people with disabilities, disabled people. I have no problem with that.
I don't either.
Well, I find that the term disabled is becoming a negative term, and people are being bullied and abused for being disabled. And I don't
I understand that disabled is a term that has been previously used by law, but I do feel that using a term, term such as individually abled would be a far more healthy and positive term to describe an individual with a certain ability or range of ability.
That describes everybody in the world. So let's, you change this to the commission on the individually able, because that's everybody.
Exactly.
Everybody.
I honestly, I live with that because I don't want to be called what you said before that, because I want to be clear like with everyone, so I think we should change to what you said for the second one.
I suggest we table this one.
I agree with tabling
this. This is the Commission on Disability.
Exactly.
You can't get away from the word, because that's our mission.
Exactly.
It's fine.
I do have to say that at one time, we had the word mental retardation, and I fought that big time.
I don't like that
I
word.
I fought that big time because of my husband's sister being labeled that, and we won it. And you do not hear that anymore.
Thank goodness.
Okay. The Commission on Disability, the disability is a matter of who you are. You could have a disability that's not visible, and it's inside. It's internal. You don't know.
Thank you.
Historically, the change was from the use of the term handicapped.
Exactly.
Yeah, I don't like that word.
Associated with being a beggar, and there was a long struggle, in fact, to codify language of disability.
Yeah.
Yep.
And I have a question. How come
this one? So, anyways, we need to make a motion to table that.
Right.
Okay.
I second
it.
Thank you, Lisa. Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
I have a question. How come it says 5 p.m. on this one?
What?
It says
okay, we've already motioned this, so we talk about it next time.
Thank you all for being here today. It's been a productive meeting so far. I'm looking forward to next month's meeting. I hope you can all attend.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Could we adjourn? I'll make a motion to adjourn.
I second it.
Thank you.
I can't be here on May 17th.